Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to the UCL Lunch Hour Lecture. We're very grateful that you're here and we're extremely grateful to have Dr. James Kilner with us. James specializes in understanding other people's behavior, which I'm sure is something that we'd all like to know more about, but he's going to talk about it from a scientific perspective because his research is about the neural basis for understanding other people's actions. Without further ado, James.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for coming. I'm going to try and give a very brief overview of this field. It's a problem that I've been interested in for just over 10 years. It's really basically how are we able to understand other people's actions? And so humans are incredibly pro-social as a species. And part of our ability to socialize is based on our ability to understand other people and to communicate with them. And obviously part of that is due to our abilities, our language abilities. There's a large part of non-verbal communication in terms of how we perceive other people that is based on how they move. And I'm going to try and take you through that. So I give you an example to start with. So I nearly always give my talks with start a talk with this example. So it frames really the question that I'm interested in. So here you're not actually seeing any movement at all. It's a static image. And what I'm interested in is what information are you able to extract when you see an image like this? And in particular, what information about this individual here are you able to extract? So if I was to ask you a question as to whether or not you think this person is throwing or catching this object, I would hope that all of you would think this person is throwing it. But there's no information in this image at all to tell you that this person is throwing it. That is an inference you've made based on your experience. And we can go a stage further than that, I could probably ask you to give a guess as to how far you think this person's throwing it. You could even have a go at what you think this person's intention is when they're throwing this object. Now, none of that information per se is present in this static image. This is inferences you've made based partly on the visual information you have and partly on your own experiences. And the research questions that I've been interested in recently revolve around how are we able to make those inferences and what parts of the brain and what networks allow us to be able to make these inferences. So really, what I'm interested in is when I look at these kind of images, is I'm interested in going inside my head and trying to ask what's going on inside here that allows me to make these inferences and perceptions. So if we take a different example that's perhaps easier to talk about, if we take the example of pouring a glass of wine, this simple act can be broken down into many different levels in which you could understand the action that you're observing. So when we do this, we could ask the question of, well, why is this action taking place? What's the intention of the person we're observing? So in this particular example, you can say the intention is to pour a glass of wine. We can also say, what are the goals of this person? How do they achieve this particular intention? So again, within the example, it may be to reach out and grasp a wine glass and a wine bottle, and then to produce the action to pour the wine into the glass. So these would be categorized as kind of what questions, what is the person doing, as opposed to why are they doing it. So the other level we can ask is basically, how are they doing it? So if I ask you to pick up a bottle, if I go and reach to pick up this bottle, there are many ways in which I can pick up this bottle. And there's only potentially a few of them that might be consistent with actually pouring the wine out of the bottle. So these are the kind of questions, these kind of how, what, and why questions are things that we can ask about observed actions. And we can draw some conclusions about what the other person's doing and whether they're doing it correctly or whether their goals meet their intentions. So when I talk about different ways of picking up a wine bottle, if you're at a dinner party and someone reaches out and picks up the wine bottle like this, I can assure you that most people stop talking because it's a very aggressive act to pick up a wine bottle in that way. And that's because their intention, or the intention that you've inferred, is very different from that which you expected. So as I say, what I'm interested in is how are we able to make these kind of inferences and what's going on inside the brain? Now, for the purposes of this talk, I'm just going to be talking about observing actions. So one logical place to start is to say, well, let's look at the visual system. So this is a human brain, and this is the back of the brain where the primary visual processing occurs. So we could say, well, what happens in the visual system that could allow us to make these kind of inferences? And there's an awful lot of processing that happens in these areas. So we know, for instance, that there are regions of the visual system that seem to be specialised and sensitive to human forms, to bodies. So this would allow us to recognise that what we're looking at is a human or a co-species. Likewise, there are neurons within the visual system that are sensitive to how people move. So animals and humans move with a particular type of motion that's called biological motion. And there are neurons in the visual system that are tuned to this type of movement. So within these two things, you have a system that's sensitive to the form of the person you're observing and to recognize that it's a human form and not a different type of form or another biological form. So all this can occur very well within the visual system. I think it's fair to say that lots of people thought that all these inferences could occur by visual processing, and we can make these inferences via visual processing. Now, this kind of simple story kind of changed radically at the beginning of the 1990s with a kind of chance discovery by a group in Italy. So the story has probably now become something of a myth and is probably much more exciting than actually what happened. But the group of Giacomo Rizzolatti and Parma were recording from an area of motor cortex called ventral premotor cortex. And what they were interested in at the time is how the neurons in this area of motor cortex encode how we grasp objects, how our hand pre-shapes when we're reaching to grasp different objects. So that could be a kind of precision grip or a big power grip or a ring pull. We can shape our hands in many different ways. And they were interested in how this area of the cortex, this motor area, was encoding those particular types of grasps. And what they discovered is that neurons that were selective for a particular type of grip during an execution, when your subject was reaching to grasp an object, they also discharged in the same way when they observed another individual performing the same action. So these were a group of neurons that didn't seem to be selected for the execution of the action, but seemed to have an overlap in between the action that was observed and executed. And they called these neurons mirror neurons, and some of you may have heard about them. And so this happened in the beginning of the 1990s, and people got very excited about this particular discovery. It seemed to suggest that we're able to be able to put ourselves quite literally in the shoes of another person, and our brain can operate in the same way as someone that we're observing. The other thing that people got excited about is they were recording from an area that was classically thought of as a motor area. So it has visual inputs, but it was not expected that these neurons should discharge when you're observing another person. So this had a lot of excitement as to why the motor system was active. So this was done in the 1990s, and in the kind of 20 years since their discovery, there's been a huge amount of research that's kind of looked at motor system activation. And I'm going to try and give you a flavour of the different styles of research to try and show that our motor system, or what was originally thought of as an area of the brain dedicated to controlling actions that we execute, is also highly activated when we observe other people executing actions. So one of the first things that was done after the discovery of these neurons was in humans was to use a technique called transcranial magnetic stimulation. And this was done by the group of Luciano Fadiga. And so transcranial magnetic stimulation is a mechanism for non-invasively stimulating bits of the human cortex. So if you stimulate the primary motor cortex and you're over the area contralateral, say, to the right hand, if you produce a stimulation of the right intensity, you'll produce a movement in, say, the right index finger. Now, it's known that if you give the same intensity of pulse while the subject is either preparing or is executing an action, you'll see a bigger response to that same stimulus. And moreover, that response is selective to whether you're making that particular movement or, say, that particular movement, whether you're abducting your little finger or your index finger. So this group reasoned that would you be able to see the same dissociation if you're observing an index finger abduction and an index finger abduction. So they performed that experiment, and they showed that the evoked potentials that you get from this transcranial magnetic stimulation show a facilitation that's specific to the muscle that you're observing. So if you're observing an index finger, you do indeed get a bigger response in your index finger. And if you're observing a little finger moving, you get a big response on your little finger. And this has been replicated lots of times since then. In humans, we can also record electrical activity non-invasively from human subjects at the scalp, either by using EEG or MEG measures. So these are measures or gross measures of neural activity that's happening inside the brain that's being recorded at the scalp. So particularly for MEG, this is recording very tiny magnetic fields that your brain produces in its normal activations. So to give an idea of how small they are, it's been said that it's the equivalent size of noise to hearing a pin drop on the M25. So these are incredibly small signals. But it's been known for over 60 years that there's a particular marker of brain activation that occurs when you execute an action. So it's known that there's a particular signature of brain activity in a particular frequency range that decreases in power when you make a movement and increases in power when you go back to being stationary. So people ask the same question, saying, well, we know this occurs during action execution. Do you see the same pattern during action observation? And indeed you do. So they reason this means that you have motor system activation in a similar way to that during execution. Lots of research has also been done looking at behavior. So are there any behavioral consequences for having the same system active during execution and observation? This would seem like quite an inefficient system if you're trying to move around the world and you're constantly using the same brain region to try and understand what everyone else is doing. Is there any leakage of the observed action into the executed action? So in this particular study, the people are subjects to do is to observe someone. You have to move your arm up and down like this while watching somebody else doing exactly the same action or producing the action in the opposite direction. And the idea was that if the same brain region is encoding the two different actions, then you may see some leakage of the orthogonal movement into your own action. So this is slightly exaggerated, but you'd be making more curved actions than you would do if you weren't observing it. And that's indeed what was shown. And this is called the interference effect. There's a strong interference effect of another person's action on your own action. Moreover, in this study, they used a robot control to make a movement that wasn't biological motion. So it turns out that if you're looking at an action that looks the same, i.e. it's moving up and down, but doesn't move with biological motion, you do not get this interference effect. It seems to be specific for biological motion. Also, the now widely used neuroimaging tool of actually looking at neural activity indirectly using measures related to the blood oxygenation, using fMRI or PET, people have shown in hundreds of studies that you get activations in this kind of motor strip when you're observing actions. And people have done some clever manipulations to try and work out what things they think might be encoded during observation of actions in these regions. Maybe predating all of them, as we know that for particular muscle groups, and particularly those in the face, is that when you're observing someone else making facial movements, you have small automatic imitation of those movements. So if you're watching someone else smiling, you'll be producing a smile yourself. If you record from the muscles in your face, people will be producing the same muscle output to a smaller degree when they're observing people smiling or when they're sad or whatever emotion you're looking at. So we have this kind of automatic imitation. So we know that during observation, we have in some situations an explicit execution of that action that we can measure. So if we look in slightly more detail to some of these studies, they can show some quite clever manipulations. So one thing that you might expect is that if you have some kind of expertise, some particular motor skill, that might change how you're able to perceive things in the world. And this is exactly what a group of researchers at UCL did about 10 years ago, is they compared a set of subjects that were either expert ballet dancers or expert capoeira dancers, and they were either observing videos of capoeira dancers or of ballet dancers. And they could look to see whether or not there was a difference in activation strength within this motor system, depending on the subject's expertise and the video they were watching. And that's indeed what they found, is they found greater activation in the motor system when ballet dancers were observing ballet dancers and when capoeira dancers were watching capoeira dancers. So this seems to suggest that your own experiences could have some effect on your activation in the motor system when you're doing an observation task. Another group in Italy run by Salvatore Aliotti, he did a really nice study looking at professional basketball players. So he was asking whether or not if you ask professional basketball players to look at a video of a basketball player taking a shot at a hoop, are they better at predicting whether that ball is going to go in or not based on the action of the basketball player? And so it turns out that professional basketball players are better at predicting the outcome of a basketball player's action. But in this particular study, they were worried about the fact that basketball players not only have greater motor expertise, but they've also spent a lot of their lives watching people playing basket, so they're also visual experts. So in this study, they controlled for that by getting the coaches and journalists who watch lots of basketball games to perform the same task. And they perform better than naive subjects, but they perform worse than basketball players. So therefore, your expertise at a motor skill has some difference on how you perceive things in the world, in this case in basketball. Another interesting area is the fact that there's a group in Italy run by Vittorio Ghilesi that's looked at whether or not you get motor system activations when you're looking at the consequences of a motor act. So this is the paintings of Fontana, which is, he basically presents a whole load of slashed canvases. And so this group were interested in knowing whether or not when you observe this artwork, do you actually have a mental representation of the action that was used to produce these particular slashes? And they found that you do. So that your motor system is active when you're viewing the consequences of a motor act, as well as just when you're observing the motor act itself. So I spent a very long time, and hopefully I can convince you, because this is quite a controversial area. But the one thing that is not controversial, and I don't know of anyone that has controversy, is that our motor systems are active when we observe other people's actions. So this is a kind of a truth. It's a very large effect. And in fact, it's not new. So William James wrote in his seminal book, every mental representation of a movement awakens to some degree the actual movement, which is its object. So part of the excitement around the discovery of mirror neurons at the early 1990s was in part because it seemed to be a neurophysiological basis for some pre-existing ideas that had existed. Now, the real question, which has yet to remain answered, is really why do we have these motor system activations? So if we accept that we do, then the question is, why are they there? What are they doing? Do they have any functional role? And so if you go back to the original research and say, well, why did they think this occurred? The idea at the time was that the visual information when we observe an action is being sent to the motor system through known anatomical connections. And this drives the motor system neurons to discharge. And the people argue is because we know how these neurons discharge when we execute an action ourselves, we can then read out, like a kind of readout table, you know, how we think the action was done, what the action was, and why the person was doing it. So the argument was, because the neurons are firing in the same way, both during execution and observation, we can just read out the information of what we would have done in that situation, and therefore we're able to understand or infer what the other person is doing. And this broadly falls under the heading of that the motor system has some role in action understanding. Now, this is where, in the literature, we start to hit some problems. And in my view, the main problem was that people were so excited about this particular discovery that it has become hugely hyped. If you were to go on Google after this lecture and type in mirror neurons, you would find thousands of hits within the last 24 hours on mirror neurons. And it becomes a very attractive and it can reduce to a simplistic idea that because of the fact that we activate something about ourselves when we observe other people, it therefore allows us to have empathy, to have lots of connections with the outside world. So lots of people who are kind of business gurus will give talks about using mirror neurons to try and improve your business. There's an awful lot of kind of sideline industry based around mirror neurons. So if you actually look at what people have claimed in the scientific literature that this kind of motor system activity underlies, there's an enormous range of varied topics. So people have said it underlies action understanding, manual communication, speech perception, speech production, physical imitation, intentionality, mental state simulation, autism, procedural learning. Well, you can read the whole list. And I hope it shouldn't take too long to realise that it's very unlikely that one neuronal population in one particular area of the brain underlies all these plethora of different things. So people got very excited about this idea. And in fact, recently, to try and correct this balance, this great book's come out by Gregory Hickok called The Myth of Mirror Neurons, which tries to unpack this kind of literature and some of the assumptions that underlie it. But if you buy into the fact that it may be involved just in action understanding like was originally proposed, there are still some problems with the framework in which it was outlined. And the problem comes in the following form. If you see someone producing an action like this, the question you've got is, how do you know where they're saying hello to you? Are they saying high five? Could they be hailing a taxi? Or are they saying to you, watch out? So the problem here is that there isn't a unique one-to-one mapping between a particular action and a particular goal or intention. We produce the same actions for many different things which have different goals and different intentions. So this becomes a very difficult problem to try and solve. How do you actually reach that goal if there's not a unique action for every goal or intention? And so this was realized by Pierre Jacob and Marc Genereau in the middle of the last decade. And they had this thought experiment about Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. So they're obviously the same person. And their thought experiment said that if you walked into a room and you saw this person pulling a knife across someone's chest, how would you know whether it was Dr. Jekyll who had the intention to try and cure that person or Mr. Hyde who was trying to murder them? Their point was simply that if you observe exactly the same action that can be linked to two different intentions or two different goals, then you can't possibly infer the goal correctly purely from the kinematics. And so they called their paper a critique of the motor theory of social cognition. So this proved a kind of problem for this theory, that this is how we're able to do it. We drive our motor system, we have this lookup table. And so if the same action can mean different things, how can we possibly understand that action? And this is a problem that I became particularly interested in. And I thought, well, what happens? This is not a unique problem to observing actions. And so what's thought to happen with other forms of perception, how they try to solve it? So if you take kind of visual perception, if I give you this seemingly random image of shades of brown and white, I don't know if anyone can see anything else in that image. Can anyone see anything in the image? Okay. So there are horses in the image. So for those of you who can't see horses in the image, you can now try and find horses in the image. So what you would now be doing, or one way to solve that problem, is you have a model in your head of what a horse looks like. And you'll be trying to fit that to these patterns here to try and see if you can see where the horse is. But if you don't know what a horse looks like, I don't believe you're going to be able to solve this particular problem. Has everyone seen the horses on? Nearly. And similarly, if you look at kind of some forms of optical illusion, so this is I particularly like this optical illusion. So you can see this person either in perspective or looking straight at you. Can everyone see that? No. And so again, it depends on having a model of what someone looks like from in profile and what someone looks like when they're staring straight at you. So you can switch between those two models. So if we ask, well, if the same action can mean different things, how can we understand the action? One solution would seem to be, well, we can make a prediction of what we think we ought to be seeing and then try and fit that with what actually we are, the information that's coming in. And this turns out that in a formal sense, this is a form of recognition model that's widely used to try and pick out things that are in a particular image. So within that framework, rather than the visual system driving the motor system, that framework would say that what happens is the motor system is active because it's trying to generate a prediction of what we are most likely to be seeing when we're observing other people. So in this way, the motor system is actually active to try and drive some information in the visual system to give it an expectation about what input it should be receiving. So here we can start off, if I'm watching someone and they say, I'm going to pour you a glass of wine, I can start off with my prediction of what I think that person's doing, I'm going to pour a glass of wine. But given that, I can then make a prediction of what goals I think they're likely to do. I can say they're really unlikely to pick up the bottle the wrong way up. They're likely to pick it up in a way that's commensurate with being able to pour a glass of wine. And I can make a prediction about how the kinematics or how their arm would move through space. Now, the best model I have of how my arm would move through space can be generated by how I myself would move my arm through space. So it turns out that our motor system would be a very good model in which to try and predict other people's actions. We're not that dissimilar on a whole, on a gross level. But this has a kind of interesting problem, which is that there is no single common perception of the world. So it means that when we're viewing the same actions or the same people doing things, we don't necessarily all perceive the same things. There are just numerous ways of interpreting worldviews. So this means that our perception is dependent on each of our past interactions with the world, so our own experiences through life and what we've learned. And it also means to say that how you may view somebody else, particularly when it comes to observing actions, may depend on how you yourself are able to move. So we've seen earlier that in expertise, people seem to have can perceive things that are present in the images that other people can't as they become experts with the basketball players. But the converse could also be true. So if we start losing some form of motor skills or are not able to move as quickly, say, through natural aging, it's possible that our perceptions of people can change because then don't conform to how we ourselves would be moving in the world. And so this is an active form of research at the moment, which is trying to look at what is the coupling between how you yourself are able to move in the world and how does that influence what you're actually able to understand from it. And this fits in with the quote of Gustave Flaubert, which basically says there is no truth, there is only perception. Or you can rephrase this by saying there is no such thing as a common reality, there is only our perceptions of reality. So to end, if we go back to the image that I started with, it's really saying that the reason that we're able to infer this information about this person is because we have experience of throwing things ourselves. We have experience of what we think our bodies would be like when we're throwing objects. And this would not be the position that we would adopt if we were catching the object. Now, if you've got a whole load of people and train them to catch an object like this, they might assume that this person is catching the object, but that's an experiment that you'd need to do. But the argument is that it's our motor system that's basically adding in the missing information that's allowing us to make these kind of inferences when we observe other people acting, and that in part enables us to be able to have good and accurate non-verbal social communication. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, James. We have 10 minutes for questions. Are there any burning questions in the audience?
You've mainly been discussing the reactions of people within our brains to essentially to actions that they've observed or have done. What about the expressions of children who haven't seen other people make facial expressions before?
Yeah, I mean, it's a very good question. So there is a sense, without wanting to get into what aspects of it could be innate, so there's a sense in which a lot of emotions that we produce, or facial emotions, we have a universality. So people generally tend to produce the same emotional expressions for the same emotional feeling. So that would be an argument that there's something about those kind of actions that is maybe different to other types of actions. There is some work that shows that children who are crawling but not yet walking have greater motor activations when they're observing crawling and not walking. And when they have progressed over to being experts in walking and not crawling, that pattern switches over. They have more motor activation when they observe walking and not crawling. So this is, there are some groups trying to address particularly those type of questions. I think it does become trickier if you're dealing with emotional expression, because it has this other aspect to it. But there is a whole range of actions that we know without having to worry about children that we have to learn. I mean, so the basketball example, the ballet dancers, they are all learned. That all the things we're learning about, we have to learn about them, because they're obviously, we're not innately born to be ballet dancers. And so there's something about those tasks that allow us to say, well, we can study them in adults and then try and extrapolate back down to infants. But it's a very good question.
Question here, and then.
Thank you very much. You ended by saying there is only truth and not, we can't say there is truth, just perception. Okay, so would we then finally say that we can always depend on our perception of thoughts of things that people are doing, or our perception of things according to our experience or something?
We do give weight to our own perceptions of other people. Whether that's the correct thing to do or not is a very different question. So we don't have access to anything else. So we can only rely on our own perceptions. Now, most of the time, now I'm given this as a kind of an example, if you like, that can be quite extreme, that we have different, but they're not wildly extreme. So in experiments that we've done that have looked at a variety of different movement disorders to look at how they make inferences on young, healthy individuals, how they move, they're not grossly out. They have a lower sensitivity, but they're all in the right direction. So it's not as if they're perceiving something that's completely wrong. They just have a smaller amount, a smaller sensitivity to be able to extract that information. So if you take the basketball players, the naive people are able to make predictions about whether or not that's going to be a correct shot or not. It's just that the degree to which it's a gross error as opposed to a fine error is going to be different. But they're not making kind of false perceptions totally. So I've kind of overplayed it. But there could be situations in which, people could be from a particular group could have particular ways of doing things that would be different to another group of individuals, and they'd have to be relearned again. But I wouldn't say it's possible, but it's not as difficult as I made out.
Oh my goodness, a forest of questions. I think this may be the end. I'll come back to you.
I wanted to ask, since the motor area and the visual area are connecting in this, is there not a component of an emotional area also connecting? Because particularly with the hailing the cab or the high-fiving, I was actually looking at the expression, and I'm guessing other people would also infer intention with an emotional component as well.
Yeah, it's a very good question. I mean, the answer is yes. I mean, this. Whenever we talk about the, so here I've just presented visual and motor areas connected together, and they're not directly connected together. They go through a complex network that's interacting the whole time with other networks that are doing other forms of processing, and all of them are being used. So I certainly don't want you to come away with the perception from this talk that the way we do it is just this way. It's just that this is potentially the reason why the motor system is active when we observe actions. But it's not the only way that we're able to extract information. And I think, you know, the example you gave about emotion and facial emotion constraining your choice of possible actions is a really good example, and is actually the reason why here, in this example, I use this image all the time, because of the fact you can't actually get any information from facial feet from the face here. Yeah. So really what this is called is, so in the our thing, it's called context. So you're basically taking contextual information. Now, within the framework, contextual information goes in the direction, back down to the, it's helping you make predictions about what it is you're likely to see. And that's all consistent with this particular framework that I've been trying to push, which is trying to say that the system's active in order to help you make predictions. But the context is one of the, is definitely a very, very important way in which you constrain what you think is a likely action. So another example I always give is that if you see someone sprinting down Oxford Street, they become a very salient person. Like, most people will look at that individual. If you see someone sprinting on a football pitch, it means nothing, because that's entirely what you expect. So it's exactly the same action, but because it falls under an expected repertoire, it has less salience than an unexpected event. But yeah, it's
possibly two questions. There's one at the back.
If you're already quite good at performing a particular action, would watching somebody else who's equally good constitute valuable practice to improve your own performance then?
So there is work done on that, exactly on that topic. So there's a very nice study on darts players trying to become more expert.
Darts players,
yeah. So it turns out it's quite a nice paradigm, because it's quite a simple outcome measure and it's simple to study. And what's interesting there is that there's a trade-off in between whether you optimally learn from looking at optimal behaviour, or whether you optimally learn by looking at when errors occur in another person. So this becomes it's not as simple as saying that if you just look all the time at the perfect action, that actually helps you learn. Sometimes looking at other people's errors are much more important than actually the outcome. Obviously, they've got to be around a meme that's kind of what you want them to be, but it's not as simple as just...
So can I get fit just by watching somebody else get fit?
Well, you do change your motor system is active when you observe other people. You have lots of responses, and people have been shown that they can lift greater weights after imagining lifting the weight themselves. I don't know if the study's been done to say if you look at someone else lifting a heavy weight that you can lift a heavy weight, but certainly people have done it with imagination. So with no overt muscle activations, people can can lift heavier weights after imagining lifting a heavy weight.
You saved me £30 a month.
But it depends who you're watching.
So it's obvious that a great deal of learning is normally involved in building up all this to a sophisticated level, but going back to possible innate bases from which it might all begin, I have several times read over a number of years of experiments in which not only pre-verbal but even pre-locomotory babies in the very first few days of perceptual life, can when they observe a screen in which there's a very large number of dots moving about, and the great majority of the dots are behaving as physical objects would in an only physical universe, in other words, they're sort of bouncing off one another like billiard balls or with Brownian motion, but one of the dots, or some, I think even in the limiting case, just one of the dots is not doing that. It is moving over long distances in ways that could only be explained by what we call purposiveness of action. That is selectively paid attention to, and fixate the gaze of the infant rivets on that and pays much more attention to it. But then I've also read that that's controversial.
Yeah, I'm sure most of these things are controversial in that field. Yeah. I mean, so I think there's an argument to say that, say, rather than necessarily talking about whether things are innate or not innate, then there's a more subtle argument that says that you're kind of born with potentially a starter kit that enables you to optimise learning. Mm. So to give an example, it might be advantageous to be born with a propensity to have a desire to look at faces. Now, what you then learn about the face from having looked at it will depend on your experiences, but you could, so that this link in between what's innate and what you're actually doing with it could be dependent on learning. But I think there's an increasing argument that, you know, what is the starter kit that you're born with that might enable you to optimize your learning? And that may fall under that category. There might be certain patterns. I don't know the studies you're talking about. But it wouldn't surprise me if it's controversial, but it also wouldn't surprise me if it was true.
You have appetite for maybe a couple more questions. Is that all right, James?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. So I have not talked about that. That is another controversial theory. So there is a theory which I think the evidence in the round does not support, which is about a kind of what's called a broken mirror theory of autism. Yeah, I think so. The simplistic part there is that if we require mirror neurons to understand other people, it's a very easy argument to make that if there's something wrong with that system, therefore we can't understand other people. It is, the evidence would not seem to support such a simple hypothesis. But there are people doing research along those lines. But I think the analysis of all the studies doesn't seem to come down in favour of such a simple... Yeah, exactly.
And
I'm interested in the time lag between witnessing an action and the relevant motor neurons activating, because presumably if they have some sort of predictive element, then they have to happen, then they need to fire in advance of seeing the action happen.
Yeah. And that, so if you design the experiment to allow people to have that information, that's exactly what occurs. So if you, so most of the time when we're doing experiments, we do, they're very different to what happens in everyday life. So people don't know what action they're going to observe, so they're having to rely on feedback. They're not able to make predictions. Now, if you design an experiment that gives people some certainty of the action that they're about to observe, you do observe motor activations prior to the observed actions. That's exactly what occurs. And that's some of the evidence that we've used to argue that the system is actually predictive and isn't just passively engaged. Yeah.
I think that's an excellent summative statement, and that's perhaps all we have time for today. So will you please join me in thanking Dr. James Kilner for a very engaging talk.
Thank you.